Last time, we took on a CrackMe challenge to cover the basics, to get a feel for where to start and what to look for. Today, we are stepping it up a bit. This new CrackMe, once again made by Andy, is a bit more challenging. It throws no easy clues at us, with red herrings, traps, and time-based stress design to slow us down, or straightly demotivate. But hey, let's buckle up and crack this thing. Just like before, this is all for educational purposes only. If you want to try it yourself, the link to the binaries is in the description. Pause the video, give it a go, then come back and check out my approach. I'll be using the free version of IDA again. Hey, I'm Pavel, a computer scientist with a PhD, software developer and engineering manager with more than 15 years of experience. On this channel, we dive into computer science topics to help you get a clearer picture of what's really going on behind the scenes. Now, this is a bit different from last time, but let's go ahead and start as usual. I'm opening up the strings, and as you can see, I'm using the same setup as before. But this time, nothing clearly stands out as a success or failure or anything remotely usable. I'm seeing these maybe dead passwords, but honestly, it feels more like a trap than anything else. All right, let me try running it. I've entered it, click register, and yeah, nothing. No pop-up, no response, not even the register string appeared in the list. We have just a window with some string I can't identify. So let's run it through IDA and nothing. Let me try again. And yeah, I think I already know what's going on. But let's say we don't know. I'll run it again and step through using F8. Now, check out the function down there. See it? IsDebuggerPresent. This is the issue, well, issue for us at least. What's happening here? We can see it's leading straight to exit process. That's our blocker, right there. You can even see it in the list, the method called IsDebuggerPresent. It is a common Windows API used by programs to check if a debugger is attached. Basically a tripwire for reverse engineers. If it detects one, the program might crash, exit, or behave differently to throw you off. It detects one, meaning true, and that's the problem. Well, it's a problem for us trying to break through. How do we bypass that? There are a couple of common tricks. There's a JZ instruction here. Remember from last time, that means jump if zero. For the jump to succeed, we need the zero flag to be set. A simple way to do that is by using XOR or sub, since subtracting or XORing a value with itself results in zero. I'm going with XOR because I think it's cooler. Yep, look at that. We are already jumping as expected. Perfect. Let's patch the file to make that change permanent. Just like last time, I'll apply the patch to the input file. And don't forget to check the box to create a backup. It's always good practice. Okay, done. Just to be sure everything's clean, I'll close everything and reopen it. Now, we can see that the XOR instruction is in place, just like we wanted. Time to run it. Perfect. And just a quick note. If we had used the more brute force bypass, like changing JZ to JNZ, we'd actually cause the program to run only under a debugger. That's not ideal. This method, on the other hand, works universally. All right, so let's move on. Now, I want to show you this next part. This is a clever little trick designed to slow down reverse engineers. We've got the strings, the debugger protection is handled, and now this. At first, it seems like nothing much is happening, but then look at this. We jump back, and again, and again. It's classic loop behavior. Check this instruction. It's comparing RSI to 31 in hex. Until these two values match, the program just spins in a loop. It's there purely to waste our time during debugging. When running normally, it goes by fast. But when you are stepping through, it's super boring. If you are familiar with the Windows API, you probably know about the classic Windows message loop. It involves functions like getMessage, translateMessage, and most importantly, dispatchMessage. We can search for those functions to check if they are present. In the message loop, Windows just processes all incoming messages and deals with them, like handling a button click that dispatch message is key because it's responsible for sending messages directly to the Windows VND proc, which is where a lot of important logic happens. To track that down, you'll want to look for where the window class is registered using a VND class structure. API call register class, later used for create window, is your indicator. Inside it, there's typically a field called long pointer to function window procedure. This points to the actual custom callback function handling window messages. That's the one you want to dig into. By the way, this jump CS IMP register class XA indicates that it doesn't contain its own logic, but instead jumps to the imported function from a DLL, in this case, likely user 32 DLL. This parameter is where we find our LPFN win proc. I double click, and here it is. The function that gets triggered when messages come in. Usually, it's a switch statement that defines what to do for each event. And since we got the register button, something must be happening here, which can give us a clue. At the end of the function, I see a message box A that catches my attention because that likely means there's some kind of success message, pop-up perhaps. So I hit register and boom, breakpoint hits. Nice. Now I can analyze the condition that triggers the message box. It might turn out to be nothing, but I really want to see what this message actually is. We could get lucky, or it might just be another red herring. We got two values here that need to match. Let's name these variables to keep track. I'll call this one var1 and the other one var2 as a variable. It's much easier to monitor. First, let's figure out where var1 gets changed. I could search, but scrolling up is faster. Aha, and here is something. And here's var2 equal var1. This is happening after a call to get dialog item text. We saw this last time. It pulls the text from the input box. Now there's another loop here. Probably more code designed to slow us down if we are stepping through. It goes from 0 to 49, just wasting cycles. Let's go past all that. Now, it's getting interesting. There are a bunch of go-to, possibly suggesting a switch statement. Let's go to label 2 to 8. Then jump to 2 to 9, and look. It's checking if the string length is 5. Inside this branch is where the actual assignment happens. var2 is being set equal to var1. I'll enter 5 characters, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, once, then hit register. var1 is now 2b67, let's see if var2 matches, and yes, it's 2b672. They are equal. That's great. Quick check. 2b67 is equal to 11111 in decimal, exactly what we entered. So we know there is no transformation happening at all. And all that code in the loops was just there to mess with us. You can try it with non-repeating pattern just to be sure. Let's stepping a bit further. And boom, pop-up shows up. Success. So these strings we saw, it was just a fake loop to throw us off. But this is it. Now, I'll try the same with the unmodified version of the program. Entering 5 characters, again, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, fours, and there it is, success. The password is just any 5 numbers. This was way more complicated than last time, but I hope you had fun. I surely did. We still have more things to talk about when it comes to reverse engineering, but that's all for today. Thanks for watching. If you like what you saw and want to see more in the future, hit the subscribe button. See you next time.